Yeah.
Do you think we should start? Yes, I think we can start now, and whoever wants to will just be joining. Oh yeah, I see more and more people are joining now. So we are all very honored to have Professor Pattison with us. He has agreed to do the keynote speech for our conference. You're very welcome, and thank you very much for showing interest in our event, Professor Pattison. So I'll just go, I'll do a very short introduction, because I'm sure that a lot of you are familiar with Professor Pattison's work. He's recently retired from his position of Professor of Theology and Modern European Thought at the University of Glasgow. Professor Pattison was previously the Professor of Divinity at Oxford University. He's written many, many books. I'll just cite a few of them. And I'd like to mention that he was one of the editors of free Oxford handbooks. And I think that the free Oxford handbooks give you an idea of his areas of interest. So the first one was the Oxford Handbook of Kierkegaard in 2013. The second one was the Oxford Handbook of Theology and Modern European Thought from the same year. And the last one, which I'm going to show you now, because I have a copy of it.
Because Lomena is also a contributor.
Okay. among many others, is the Oxford Handbook of Russian Religious Thought, which came out just very recently. Let me show you a copy of the book.
Oh.
And now, oh, it's quite a thick one. Now, picture
on the cover. which picture on the cover?
It's Nicholas Roerich.
Roerich. Oh, yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Now, San Sergio Sobradnish. Yes.
Yeah. You know, the reason I'm actually showing the book is not so much to advertise the book, but because I thought it's an interesting thing that a number of our participants in the conference are cited in the book. So, for example, Professor Lidov, Oleg Tarasov, Tatiana Levina. When you look at the bibliography, you will see a lot of these, the people that you see here today. And I, when we were organizing the conference and thinking of whom to invite, we just thought it would make sense that all these people actually in some way, in some context, brought together. Now, as you see, you know, Professor Pattison has worked a lot on Kierkegaard, on Heidegger, on Dostoevsky. He's done also quite a lot of work on aesthetics from the point of view of theology, aesthetics, especially the aesthetics of visual arts. And I'm just going to cite a book which I think is relevant to our workshop, and also I've used it quite a lot. It's called Crucifixions and Resurrections of the Image, Reflections on Art and Modernity. This is on from 2009. So without much ado, Professor Pattison, we're looking forward to your talk.
Good. Well, Clemena, thanks a lot. And I think when I accepted to speak, I wasn't aware I was being a keynote speaker, but just thought I was participating. So, and I feel, given the kind of quality of the presentations, it's quite a weight to carry. But I should emphasize that I work mainly in the area between philosophy and theology, with particular interests relevant to this workshop, such as Russian thought and as you say, visual art. But I'm not a specialist in iconography or art history. And I should say that I'm not offering a theory of icons, but I'm just trying to draw out one aspect of icons. So what I say about icons, I don't imagine that this explains everything. I'm not trying to do that, but just to pick up one point. And I'm also aware that, you know, I'm coming in a way as an outsider into sort of areas where there are lots of controversial points, and sometimes one treads on people's toes, and I don't mean to do that. I'm aware of some of these points, even if I don't understand everything that hangs on them, as it were, as someone who spends 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, sort of working on these things must do. a lot of my recent work has been developing what I call a philosophy of Christian life, and with an emphasis on Christian living rather than Christian doctrine. Philosophy of religion is often oriented, does God exist? You know, can someone be both God and man? And these kind of theoretical questions. But instead, I've tried to start from Christian life. And of course, icons are a phenomenon of Christian life, as well as being the subject of doctrinal definition. And it's in a way the use of icons that's more the focus on my paper than what the official teaching of the church has said about them. Not that they're necessarily incompatible at all, I don't really go into that. Because icons are a way of making present the divine persons or mysteries that they depict, they're always going to be doctrinally loaded. And of course, the way in which they manifest doctrinal truth is clearly different from what goes on under the name of theology, as that gets hammered out in church assemblies and academic research and debate. And even if we call icons visual theology, as many do, that's still something different from theology written and debated. So my title indicates already what I understand to be a distinctive function of the icon, namely to make present the person or the mystery that it depicts, and to do so in such a way that the power of that person or mystery becomes effective in the lives of believers. This gives the icon an especially significant role in the life of Christian communities, but at the same time, it's precisely this function of making the power of the divine present that also makes the icon a site of potential abuse, because power is both inherently unstable and the object of near insatiable desire on the part of human beings. We all want power of one kind or another, but power is unstable. We want power because without power, we are utterly exposed to the contingencies and uncertainties of this mortal life. But I want to begin by showing a short extract, about 3 minutes, from Sergei Bondarchuk's 1960s film of War and Peace. It's a scene with which many of you are probably familiar, and it takes place on the eve of the Battle of Borodino as the Russian army and an accompanying corps of peasant laborers prepare their defenses against the impending French attack. I don't know what the sound will be like. It didn't work too well yesterday, but it was okay earlier today.
Yeah.
Good. So except for the fact that Tolstoy sets the scene at noon, and this seems to be late afternoon, essentially this is very faithful to Tolstoy's novel, though it tends to make explicit what is only implicit in Tolstoy's very simple narrative description at this point. So we're left in no doubt that Our Lady of Smolensk is the object of veneration of the entire army, binding together men of every class, from the peasant laborers, through the common soldiers, through the officers, all the way up to Kutuzov himself, compelling even the skeptical Pierre to remove his hat and cross himself. As an aside, I'd say that however idealized this may be, it perhaps does reveal something distinctly Russian, a point that can be demonstrated by noting the near impossibility of a similar ritual moment having occurred in the British forces gathered before the Battle of Waterloo. Tolstoy shows even the great general, this scion of an aristocratic family with a palace in central St. Petersburg, falling on his knees before the icon in essentially the same spirit of humility as an ordinary peasant. But this would be quite inconceivable in the case of someone like the Duke of Wellington, for whom any gesture of self-abasement in the sight of the lower ranks of the army would be completely out of the question, a completely different code, if you like. But just what is being sought in this act of veneration? Of course, I'm aware this is a literary and film description. I have no idea at all about the real personality of Kutuzov, just Kutuzov as he's represented here. So one answer, which is very tempting to my secular generation, brought up on the idea of Christianity as the ideology of empire, is that the use of an icon here is very much the same being used as a kind of battle flag, a rallying point for the army as it prepares for battle. Is this a sign in which to conquer? A crusader's flag, perhaps, a talisman, a sort of source of extra military valor. And I think that question can be extended to the use of icons in more general contexts of national or communal self-affirmation in general. What does it mean for the icon to be the unifying sign of a we, a collectivity that's engaged in pursuing its interests in the world in competition with other national entities and other communities? Is this not a subversion, perhaps, of its legitimate function as an object of religious veneration, perhaps even a secular and implicitly violent usurpation? Yesterday there was some discussion about the adoption of icons and the reconstruction of icons as part of the imperial ideology of later 19th century Russia. Now, of course, the use of icons in warfare is not entirely modern. Again, many of you will be familiar with this icon in which, with the help of Our Lady of the Sign, the Novgorodians repel the attacking Suzdalians. And it's possible today, of course, to go to Novgorod and to see this icon in the museum, and then to go to the cathedral and to see the icon of Our Lady of the Sign there itself in situ. In the cathedral. And my experience of that was kind of quite extraordinary effect on one's sense of time, in a way that there one was, well, in the late 20th century, when I visited it, looking at an icon that itself represented an icon from several centuries before. And of course, the use of icons in warfare goes even further back, notably in the Byzantine use of the icon of the Theotokos Black Enitissa to defend the city against attacks by Persians and later by Arabs. And we might also note in this context that the relic of the protecting veil of the Virgin was deployed in the 9th century to repel an attack from Rus, still pagan. Here, I suggest we see an interesting and important pointer to what I believe to be a major element in the role of icons, namely that there's a considerable overlap between how icons are used and how relics are used. In this case, as a defense in warfare, but also in healing, agriculture, business affairs. The most significant bridge between the relic and the icon is also to be found in Byzantium, specifically the relic known as the Mandilion. The legend of the Mandilion, you probably all know it, but I'll summarize it. First found in Eusebius' church history, tells the story of the Syrian king Abgar of Edessa, who suffered from a skin disease. Hearing of the miracles being wrought in Palestine by Jesus of Nazareth, Abgar sent a delegation to summon the savior to his court. He, however, didn't go, but took a cloth and impressed on it an image of his face, which he then returned to Abgar. The image itself was, of course, sufficient to bring about the hoped-for cure. So 2 points merit special comment. Firstly, this image was not a work of art, but an image not made by hands. In other words, it was as much a relic as an icon in our modern sense. It wasn't a painted object. It was a physical object directly made sacred by its direct association with the physical body of the savior. And in that sense, as comparable to Mary's veil or the crown of thorns as to any later pictorial representation. And it's a significant element of the story that although Abgar had sent his court painter to paint an image of the savior, that the painter wasn't able to do this because of all the crowds swirling around. So the only possible image was the one not made with hands. Secondly, it was, of course, nevertheless, a relic that bore an image and as such became the model for the painted icon of the savior's face. As such, it became a kind of guarantee of the veracity of the image, which is an important point in classic defense of icons, such as we find in John of Damascus. For whom, what's important is that the icon is, one of the many important things is that the icon that's venerated is not a made-up work of art. It's not a product of the human mind, but a faithful depiction of the savior as he was when he made himself visible in the incarnation. And the relic of the image not made with hands becomes the guarantee of the faithfulness of this depiction. This guarantee, this continuity, facilitates the transfer of the properties of the relic to the painted image so that it can do what the relic was also able to do as an actual extension of the body of the savior. For the Damascene, the image of Christ was Christ, just as he says, the image of the emperor is the emperor, a point I take to refer, for example, to the imperial image on coinage or other symbols of authority. When you see the symbol, you respond to them as you would respond to the emperor. To insult the symbol is to insult the emperor. So the same logic would also be extended to relics and icons of saints. Like the relic, but differently, the icon of the saint, is able to do what the saint is able to do. So the Mandilion is the most renowned example of an image not made with hands in the East, but there are, of course, comparable phenomena in the West. Now, where's my cursor gone? Unfortunately, that's now shown up so that it's rather obliterated by the pictures of people, but you can all see what it is. The idea that a truly holy image is not just a product of human art, but involves a direct divine intervention was a powerful one. Examples continued to the threshold of the Renaissance. Clearly, the best known examples are the legend of Veronica's cloth and the Shroud of Turin. In some ways, the story of Veronica's cloth contains similar elements to that of Abgar, though in this case, the image is captured as the result of a human being coming to the assistance of the divine rather than the divine coming to the assistance of the human being. The image itself, as represented in paintings, the original is lost, is often strikingly similar to that of the icon not made with hands, although the Veronica first appeared around the 13th century, possibly reflecting the reception of an icon not made with hands in Rome. Interestingly, in terms of this similarity, although many of the images of the Veronica cloth show the crown of thorns, the image I've chosen is one, again, quite many, in which the crown of thorns is absent, which makes it much more like the image not made with hands. And sometimes in art books, of course, these are confused, and you'll see an image of the icon, the Mandylion, referred to in a subtitle as the Veronica icon. So there's quite a bit of confusion around that. This is quite a strong theme in this period. Also in the 13th century, we find the legend of the Friar Bartolomeo, who was charged with painting the eponymous scene in the Annunciation in the Church of the Most Holy Annunciation in Florence. Bartolomeo found it very difficult to paint the face of the Virgin in a way it ought to be painted. And so, of course, being a monk, he went away and prayed about it overnight. But he came into church the next morning to discover that an angelic hand had completed his work, so that the face of the Virgin in this painting is being painted by an angel. So again, although it's a painting, it's also in a sense a relic. It has a direct physical contact with the divine. And that story itself, I think, underlines significant differences between medieval and modern ways of looking or thinking about holy images. Hegel said, and I think in many ways rightly, about our relation to medieval art, that no matter how skillfully or beautifully the artist portrays the subject, we no longer bow the knee, as he put it. To put it bluntly, what the modern visitor to Florence usually sees is a Giotto or a Fra Angelico and not the Mother of God. Legends such as those of the Mary of the Most Holy Annunciation Church remind us that the medieval eye saw very differently. Now, clearly the patrons who paid for this and for the many other splendid works of Florentine art wanted the magnificence of the work to be seen. They were very interested in the visual effect, but for many this was secondary to the power of the work as a direct connection to the divine. And it's here that the continuity between icon and relic is important. In his classic study, The Cult of the Saints, Peter Brown describes the rise of the cult of relics in the ancient church in the 3rd and 4th century. Though his focus is on the Western Latin church, his examples come from around the Mediterranean basin, and it's clear that much of what he describes is also relevant to what would become the world of the Eastern Church. As Brown tells the tale, the cult of relics effected a transformation of late Roman society, enabling the replacement of older pagan Roman networks of kin and friendship with a new set of networks that transcend the narrowness of the older model. An especially important role is played by the grave of the saint. Already there were cults associated with the graves of the biblical patriarchs. According to Guy Strumser, there was a cult of the tomb of Abraham that was used actually by Christians, Jews, and later Muslims up until the 8th century, all sharing the same grave cult. To be buried, or to have a loved one buried in proximity to the saint, is to get an assurance of protection, of being looked after in the passage to the next life in an exceptional way. Thus far, the cult was still likely to be the preserve of the well-to-do, people who could afford to have relatives reburied or to arrange for their own shrines to be built. People like Paulinus of Nola, a rich landowner who used his wealth to develop the shrine and cult of St. Felix, his heavenly friend and patron, and both Felix and Paulinus are buried here together in the same chapel. Of course, when the bodies of the saints began to be broken up and distributed far and wide, the cult became radically democratized and no longer the preserve of the rich. Staying with Felix, there's a little bit of his bone. Bone, a fingernail, a lock of hair, an item of clothing could make the saint present anywhere throughout the Christian world. So I now live near St. Andrew's, which is called St. Andrew's, of course, because in the Middle Ages, it received the relics of St. Andrew, being an apostle, of course, especially powerful, especially important relics. Though naturally, relics associated with Christ himself, with Mary, with the apostles, retained priority over others, relics of other saints also made Christ's power present in their communities. John of Damascus famously commented, "To limit the number of permissible icons to those of Christ himself and to a narrow range of biblical topics and persons would be to rob the king of his army." But the saints are not only Christ's army in an external sense. John also argues that through deification, they are the living and rational temples for the dwelling place of God, and God's divine power also passes to their image. So if relics effect one democratization of the presence and power of the saint, the image represents another. Not every local church can have the benefit of an important relic, although the market forces of medieval Europe ensured a massive supply of these. As has often been said, you could create a forest out of the fragments of the true cross. Personally, I've seen at least three pointing fingers of St. John the Baptist, all from his right hand. And there are probably many, many more. But of course, even though not every church can have a relic of St. Andrew or of John the Baptist, every church can have an image. And as time went on, every household and every individual could also have their own image, a conduit for the presence of divine power in everyday life. And this proliferation also allowed for the increasing specialization of these powers. So particular saints could, of course, be looked for help with toothache, burns, childlessness, etc. Both the faithful and the scoffers who scoffed at the cult of relics, both are able to offer a virtually endless stream of anecdotes illustrating these wonder-working powers. So at a very basic level, in this regard, the icon is not, as a modern secular viewer might think, a mere representation, an attempt to picture an absent object. It is a living entity in its own right, inhabited by the persona of the saint. And here it seems to me there's a certain tension in the defense of images, which runs on all the way through early iconodules such as John, down to contemporary apologetics. On the one hand is what we might call a Platonic argument, namely that the sensuous qualities of the image can be used as a way of lifting the mind to the realm of higher and invisible things. On the other is almost the opposite argument, a more materialistic argument, that the image is the way in which the inhabitants of the higher realm, Christ and his saints, become present to us in the actual world in which we live. I'm just changing that now because I don't want you to have to be looking at a bit of skeleton for 3 or 4 minutes without a break. So now we have an icon of St. Seraphim, who, just because I happen to like him, I think I once saw a piece of his prayer shawl as well, but I can't now remember where that was. So it's this second argument that the continuity between relic and icon brings into focus. And so here too, we may note how in normal church practice, believers don't spend their time just looking at the icon. They kiss it, and they pray before it. They look to it, but not necessarily at it. To enter a church rich with icons is not to enter a gallery, but it's to arrive at a party surrounded by wise and helpful family, elders, and friends, to be amongst those who love us and who can do good for us. Of course, as with all human relationships, things go wrong, and if the help looked for help doesn't come. Professor Tarasov tells the story of a group of Russian peasants who pleaded to an icon to help put out a fire, but nothing happened. And so in the end, they threw the icon into the fire with the words that if it wouldn't help them, then it must help itself. Now, that might be kind of cited as an example of peasant ignorance, but in a sense, what they're saying is consistent with a whole way of thinking and experiencing the icon as bearing the persona of the saint. None of this is to say that visual properties of the image are unimportant, merely to emphasize that they're only one aspect of the icon's function in Christian life as it's lived. Though representing the visual likeness of its subject matter isn't the primary aim of the icon, it is, as I said, with regard to the mandilion, a necessary condition. It's the guarantee of its capacity to function as a bearer of the power of its subject. You can't make the saint look however you feel like making it look. I shall return to the question with which I began, namely what it means to venerate an icon in the context of national or communal self-affirmation. But first, I want to make another digression via another important subtopic that relates both to the cult of relics, obviously, and the cult of icons, namely the small matter of death. As I've already observed, Brown sees graves as being an early focus of the cult of the saints. Already prior to Christianity, as evidence of the ancient world falling under the spell of an increasingly dark and threatening sense of death. Here we might compare the graves of early Etruscan art, I think this is from around the 6th century BCE, with those of the later Roman period. So the art of the earlier period shows that the inhabitants of the tombs happily enjoying their favorite pursuits, such as hunting, or in this case, partying. Later tombs, again, this is partially obscured, at least on my screen, by faces, but here you see the recently deceased being, as it were, torn away and separated from their loved ones and taking through the gates of the underworld, which is guarded by a rather sinister figure, and there are also other figures which are more kind of actively malevolent looking. So death becomes a kind of object of fear and terror in a way in which it didn't seem to be so earlier on. So by the 2nd and 3rd centuries of the Christian era, as Brown again emphasizes, death was for pagans a dark, fearful, and shameful thing. Christian faith in the resurrection of the body offered a powerful counter-narrative. And this wasn't just theoretical, but also involved a changing practice with regard to burials and the care of burial sites. Where the bodies of unbelievers became rotten and foul, those of the saints were observed to be fragrant and even beautiful. Gregory of Tours writes of his dead ancestor, Gregory of Longa, that in death, his face was so filled with glory that it looked like a rose. It was deep rose red, and the rest of his body was glowing white, like a lily. Paulinus marveled at what Brown called the awesome stillness of Felix's remains. The trees and flowers that flourished at the graves of the saints were said to provide evidence that they were now in paradise because of the association of gardens with paradise, as in this slightly strange icon of Christ resting in the time between his death and the harrowing of hell, and talking with his mother. And again, there's this motif of the garden, so that the grave became a kind of beautiful garden where the blessed saint rested in peace. So again, the cult of the relic provides one route by which the promise of the resurrection can become a real reality now. The very tininess of the relic, that it might be only a very small fragment of bone or drop of blood, demonstrated the power of the heavenly over the earthly, according to what Brown calls a logic of inverted magnitudes. The dismembered body of the saint, distributed amongst the faithful, acquires the character of ubiquity that Protestant theology ascribed to the body of Christ. It's a medium of life that's become almost entirely separated from the fate of a localized and rotting corpse. Even though it's only a little drop of blood, its power can become present and effective virtually anywhere, and it's able to prevail over physical forces, in some cases human enemies, that are much greater than itself. And the same is true of the icon. The face of the saint depicting the icon is, of course, a human face. But it's not, for the most part, until the Baroque period, a face painted in accordance with ideas of individual subjective personality, such as a familiar in Western religious art from the Renaissance onwards. Professor Tarasov does note that in some cases the features of the saint, particularly in the 15th, 16th, 17th century Russian saints, may have been derived from portraits made on the occasion of their deaths and drawing on eyewitness accounts. And thus far, the requirement of verisimilitude seems to be entering in. He observes that in this period, the Baroque, the iconic face too, became to some extent individualized. Saints, like the rest of us, possess their own likeness. But as he also points out, even in this degenerate period, as was discussed yesterday, the illumined countenance remains a kind of borderline phenomenon. Here it's important perhaps that the portrait is drawn at or near the point of death. As a borderline or liminal phenomenon, it reveals both the divine image in which human beings are created and individual personality. Death, for the saint at least, is precisely the moment of transition from earthly to heavenly life. Again, the icon that's up before us, in a sense, illustrates what's been a tension in Christian eschatology ever since, that on the one hand, in popular belief, the dead die to go to be with Christ, they go to be with in paradise, tonight you will be with me in paradise. On the other hand, the last judgment is still many, many years away, and there's a tension here that's kind of not entirely resolved. But to the extent that the saint goes in some way directly to be with God, the face or countenance of the dying or recently dead saint belongs simultaneously to two worlds, not as in the case of Christ by virtue of their innate twofold nature, but on account of their faithfulness to Christ and his vindication of their faith through the miracles they're able to perform, including the miraculous preservation or even transformation of their bodies. So here's Teresa of Lisieux, whose miraculously preserved body is one of the most kind of popular relics in 20th century Catholicism. So in this way, the icon, like the relic, could mediate divine power, not only in a general way, but with relation to the individual believer's particular experience of death. It's a major point of discussion in the interpretation of Dostoevsky's The Brothers Karamazov, that the body of the holy elder Zosima begins against all expectation on the part of his followers to rot soon after his death. Here it seems it's Dostoevsky's testimony that in the world of modernity, we can't expect the kind of immediate revelations of divine presence and power vouchsafed to our ancestors. Though we may nourish hopes of immortality, we do not have direct access to that heavenly world, but we remain, as Dostoevsky said of himself, suspended in a crucible of doubt. Yet it's striking and less often observed that the rotting body of Zosima is not quite Dostoevsky's last word in the novel. And in the epilogue, he leaves us with an image of a face that is transfigured in death, namely the face of the child Ilyusha, who after dreadful suffering lies in his coffin. Quote, his thin face was hardly changed at all, and strange to say, there was no smell of decay from the corpse. The expression of his face was serious and as it were thoughtful. His hands crossed over his breast looked particularly beautiful, as if chiseled in marble. Here perhaps we see again the awesome stillness of the dead, of which Paulinus of Nola spoke many centuries before. So although the content of Alyosha's farewell discourse can be glossed and often has been glossed in entirely secular terms, the transfigured body of Ilyusha hints that his hope is not for this life only. So the relic and the icon may be media of many particular interventions in warfare, healing, agriculture, etc., but perhaps their overarching role is in relation to the last things. In communicating the presence of the living God and his army, the communion of saints, they provide assurance that we are not defined solely as mortals, but also as members of a community that transcends death and isn't destroyed by the prospect facing each of us of becoming a rotting corpse. Ultimately, we are all helpless before death, and even the wonders of modern medicine can only postpone and not remove the end of earthly life. The icon marks this ultimate limit, a point at which finite mortal existence stands before an immortal heavenly life in which we're united with all we have loved and with all who love us. I come back to War and Peace and to the image of General Kutuzov kneeling before the icon of Our Lady of Smolensk. And there is, I think, at least arguably, a world of difference between the function of the icon represented in this scene, at least in the novel and the film. I'm not sure about this painting, but a world of difference between the function of the icon and that of a crusader's battle flag. And the crucial difference is that, as portrayed by Tolstoy, the great general is shown acknowledging that there is a limit to his power and the power of his army, of which in this moment he is the embodiment. So it's not just a gesture that acknowledges the uncertainty of the outcome of the impending battle. It's more an acknowledgement that he and his soldiers are all equally exposed to individual and collective death, that they stand before a power that is greater than any human power, a power that no human being and no society has at its disposal. The power of the icon is in the revelation that there is a power other than that of the all-destroying and indifferent fate of the classical world, or the infernal machine that Dostoevsky saw in Holbein's painting of the dead Christ. We may be helpless before the power of death, but even in our helplessness, precisely in acknowledging our helplessness, another kind of life is revealed, of which the defining principle is all-embracing compassion and equality. Now, this may not seem to amount to much, but we can glimpse something of its significance if we compare the attitude of Kutuzov, at least the fictional Kutuzov, with that of the post-Christian societies of the modern world. Perhaps like people in all ages, in all times of crisis, when the earth moves and foundations are shaken, we look to our leaders for assurance and guidance. But the particular myth of our time is that our leaders have, or should have, the human and technical competence to secure a good outcome, to do a good job, as the American president says of himself in relation to COVID, and we may or may not choose to believe him. For the majority of our contemporaries, it seems that there is no power beyond that of society or that of the leaders in whom society invests its hope. If society fails, or if our leaders fail, and some of them are failing quite badly at the moment, we just do not know where to turn and are indeed helpless. And it's this situation that perhaps encourages leaders to instrumentalize traditional symbols of religious life. And we can see this in Christianity, Judaism, Islam, Hinduism, and Buddhism as means of underwriting the power that they wield. But my argument has been that this is very different from seeing in those symbols or experiencing those symbols as a reminder of the limits of human rational, technological, economic, and military power. Even for those who cannot embrace Christian belief in a communion of saints eschatologically united with God in Christ, the icon is at the very least a reminder, never more timely than in a time of crisis, that the world is not at our disposal, not a mere resource to fuel whatever kind of life we want to lead. For the icon a dual, of course, the icon is much more than this, but I think that even this limited and negative lesson is important. Thank you. Okay, I've stopped sharing.
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. I thought this was such an interesting talk, because I think that in a way it went to the heart of the very concept of our conference. This is why the abstract of the conference starts with a quote by Nietzsche. I'd like to open the floor for questions, comments, any sort of interventions from our participants.
Okay, may I say a few words? Yes. About the stimulating paper by Professor Pattison. I think that we're going in the same direction, because I believe, and I'm trying to present it in several papers, that there is an extremely important notion for the understanding not only Russian culture, but the way, in a way, Byzantine way of thinking in general, because Russian culture obviously belongs to the Byzantine tradition and the Byzantine paradigm in a way. And this notion, I mean, it's crucial for many topics. It's the notion of iconicity. It's not directly relates to icons as objects. It's a notion to explain the vision of the world. So, well, iconic dimension of the world. And the crucial aspect of this is the space. So the icon, not a flat and decorative picture as most people perceive it. I mean, flat decorative picture charged with religious meaning, but it's originally, ideally spatial. So, and therefore I liked very much this point in Professor Pattison's presentation. Even he did not emphasize it, but it was in the discussion and in the pictures that icon is space. So, because it's originally, it's a mediating realm in comparison, for example, with the Western religious pictures. And the icon, as I am trying to prove in some of my articles, is not a subdivision of the religious pictures, but it belongs to principally different metrics. And these metrics we may explain through the notion of iconicity. And again, about this, so icon, the ideal icon is always space mediating between heavenly and earthly realms. And therefore, it creates the space. And the space itself might be perceived as an icon. And therefore, in the context of hierotopy, we proposed the new notion of spatial icon. From this point of view, every church might be considered as a spatial icon, and every time a unique spatial icon, with all media working simultaneously. I mean, architectural, visual, ritual, the dramaturgy of lighting, arrangement of perfumes, and so on. So all this media practically creates what we call spatial icon. And the icon is an object, as a part of this, well, iconic sacred space. And I mean that what we could see at the beginning is this episode from War and Peace movie by Bondarchuk, that is the creation of this sacred space in a very profane environment of the battlefield. And it's naturally, Bondarchuk did not have an idea of spatial icon, but he had a great intuition, and he made quite impressive visual embodiment of this phenomenon. And yes, by the way, the Soviet censors felt it. And when I saw the movie for the first time in my childhood, well, I was teenager then. So, well, they cut out this episode from the movie.
Interesting.
Yes, it's because they realize that it's something challenging and not possible to adopt into the primitive atheistic ideology of that time. So, yeah.
And yes, I mean, I think what you're saying sparks the thought that, and again, it's interesting with the cult of relics that these are often taken in procession or transferred from one place to another, so that not only is the
exactly
space inside
exactly
the church, but so 2 years ago, I think, the relics of St. Teresa of Lisieux were brought to Scotland and taken around the different Catholic churches in Scotland. So this is, and you can see the same, as you say, with the icon can be taken in procession to a battlefield or to some other situation, sacralizing.
Yes, you are right. Space. And the main point, the principal point, is to create a particular sacred space through the miraculous icon. We should stress this aspect, miraculous icon or a relic, because both, according to the Byzantine theology, are the temples of the Holy Spirit. So they're containers of the divine grace. And moreover, they are all creating particular sacred space full of this divine grace. So it's very powerful phenomena. So in many cases, the relics and miraculous icons are the vehicles of hierotopy. So, and means of hierotopy. And originally the idea of hierotopy came to my mind through these studies in miraculous icons and relics. And we did, by the way, a program 20 years ago in conjunction with this great jubilee of 2000 years of Christianity. We did a research program dedicated to the Christian relics. And we did then two big exhibitions. First of all, in the Moscow Kremlin museums, we did the exhibition Christian Relics in the Moscow Kremlin. By the way, it was the first exhibition of relics in Russia. And even exhibition of relics as a phenomenon, not reliquaries or masterpieces of applied art, but relics as a cultural and spiritual phenomenon. And another exhibition was, by the way, it's also might be interesting for you. It was a big exhibition of the Mendelian in Russian icons. And in some years it was published in a big monograph and catalog of the Holy Face in Russian icons. And also some other books published in conjunction with this events. And the main point was, which I expressed in my introductory article, it's by the way available in English too, because the catalog of the Christian relics in the Moscow Kremlin was bilingual. The introductory article was entitled The Sacred Space of Relics. So, and was exactly the point I expressed there, that relics and miraculous icons from the point of view of perception of the Orthodox believers belong to the same category of things. It's in a way the same matter, and matter which is able to create particular sacred spaces everywhere they appeared. And so thank you very much for this episode from War and Peace movie, because I even did not remember about this, because I could not see it in the Soviet period. And
of course,
it's not a question but a comment, but I just would like to stress that I'm very pleased, because we are thinking in the very same direction.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Lido. Professor Pattison, would you like to respond in some way to these comments? To me, it actually looks it's very useful to have all these categories working together.
Yeah. I think, as an example,
Professor power, Lidov, presence, hierarchy.
I mean, I think what Professor Lidov just said about miraculous icons is relevant to, if you like, the crossover between the icon and the relic. So when we have these icons of weeping Madonnas or ones that bleed, then the icon again is clearly no longer just a picture, but itself is a kind of active participant as well. With regard to the sacralization of space, I remember in the 1990s, in that kind of difficult period in Russian life, I had a Russian acquaintance who collected a number of icons and hired an aeroplane and got together with a bishop and flew all over Russia so that the blessing of the weeping icons could be given to the entirety of the Russian land. So, you know, this is not just something happening in the Middle Ages, but of course people still feel this power. And I think there's a big difference between the episode in War and Peace, and of course I chose to end with the still from Ivan the Terrible, which of course not only in the film, but the very fact that he could include the episode of the role of the church in gathering the Russian people, of course reflects, if you like, the more cynical use of the icon and religious power by Stalin during the period of the Great Patriotic War. So suddenly realizing, you know, you can use religion in a sense in order to assist the aims of the state.
I'm sorry, but there are no proofs. There are no documents. Mostly, it's legends.
Well, I'm happy to pass on.
Well, but I think it's beautiful legends about Stalin's use of icons and relics, but I don't know any precise documents about this.
We will come to him tomorrow, I think.
Professor Pattison, can I ask a question on behalf of Petra? Petra, if you want to, you can ask it yourself, or I can read it, because I think it's very clearly formulated. So Petra's question is, have you read Martin Hegglund's This Life, where he argues with Marx and Hegel that Christian faith is precisely not a faith of the limit, as you wonderfully depict, but a faith of the unlimited, hence opposed to any proper societal change? What do you say to his argument?
Well, the short answer is I haven't read his book. And the slightly longer argument is that on the couple of sentences, I'm not quite sure how he would make the connection between Christianity being a faith of the unlimited and therefore opposed to any proper societal change. In a way, it's easier to think historically that the emphasis on the finitude and the limitations of human powers and capacities has always been a very strong element in conservative religious rhetoric, and saying to human, you know, particularly in the debate with the Enlightenment and with, as it were, the technological Enlightenment and this idea of homo deus, that we have virtually infinite technological resources now at our disposal and can do anything. It's been for 200 years a fairly standard response by the churches to say, well, actually we can't. We are finite, limited mortal beings. We don't know everything. We have to die. Therefore, we have to know our place. And then this often segues into a sort of comment on social order and the fact that one shouldn't disrupt social order. So I don't quite see how his argument would work. So I can't quite answer the question in the terms posed. I'd need to hear a bit more.
I could just say that. Thank you. It's been an ongoing debate after his book, and I just thought that your presentation today was a beautiful, well, really argument against it in a way that I appreciate it, although I also like his argument in a sense, but just the way that you pictured the icon as a limit that marks the limit and the beginning of the new, in a sense. I just thought that was beautiful, and in case you had read it, I thought, yeah, you could develop, you could move on from his thesis.
No, I've heard of the book before, so obviously it's something I will need to read at some point. But as I say, I don't quite see how one would get from an argument or from an understanding of faith as the unlimited, the infinite, to being opposed to societal change. So when you do have, say, in Schleiermacher, a theologian in 1799 who reinvents Protestant faith, at least, as kind of an experience of the power of the infinite, this is a radical and revolutionary and innovative move, and one that is supportive of societal change in a whole range of ways. So, I need to know more.
Yeah, no, he also ends with Martin Luther King being being his kind of way out. So, yes, I mean, there are some weaknesses in his theological analysis.
Yeah, Professor Pattison, can I say something, which is just to ask how you see that? On the one hand, I think that, I don't know. I think that there are two oppositions running in the understanding of the power and the presence that is revealed in icons. On the one hand, there is the idea that the cult of icons is typical of lower uneducated classes, women especially. And then I think that that's why it was such a nice image to see part of the movie that you showed, because this is the whole idea that you have all classes, all the way from Kutuzov down to simple soldiers that pray before the Mother of God. So on the one hand, you have this opposition. On the other hand, you have the opposition that this is a very pre-modern way of experiencing an icon, and it's something completely foreign to a modern secularized modernity. And I was thinking in this context of quite a well-known book among art historians by David Friedberg, The Power of Images. And basically, he talks there about the power of images very much in terms of you, the way you spoke about the dimension of presence in the image. But he also points out to what an extent this is something that spills over into the modern period.
I mean, I think this is...
as well, and one of the ways in which we see that is... Did I freeze again?
Yes, no, I started talking because you froze and I thought you'd stopped, but...
Oh, okay, sorry. Well, I was just saying that the opposition that the belief in presence as revealed by an icon is only something which is typical of the pre-modern perception of an image and is something foreign to modernity. I wonder to what how you see that, because you know there are also scholars who actually point out that every visual image has a sense of revealing presence, what Gadamer calls picture magic. So it is always there.
Yes, I mean, I think clearly at a certain theoretical level, this is the case, and modernity has developed various theorizations of the human being, which would make this kind of relation to images something pre-modern. But of course, it's a big question as to whether modern people really are as modern as they think they are. So several examples. So flags. I mean, I was a student at Scotland in the 1960s, and you hardly ever saw a saltire, the blue and white national flag of Scotland then. I made some comments at my beginning about Scottish independence today, and now you see Scottish national flags everywhere you go in Scotland, on people's cars, in their houses. You only occasionally see a Union Jack. If you do see a Union Jack, you can guess that that person is a conservative unionist. So it becomes a very powerful, loaded. When I go to England, I'm just really, you know, it's quite a physical shock to see the Union Jacks, even though that's what I grew up with, of course, as the national flag. So these images do have a visceral physical power. Then, you know, we live in a time in which not people of my age, but the younger generation have all covered themselves with tattoos, you know, for whom life is represent, their own lives are represented to themselves through their tattoos, which are, you know, people choose them for all sorts of different reasons, but some of them are clearly very important personal ones. I remember a soldier I knew in my childhood, really. He was just a few years older than me. He came back one time and he rolled up his sleeve and there was a Roman eagle tattooed on it. And he said, you know what that is? And I said, what's that? And he said, that's Julius Caesar's badge. So for him, somehow the power of Caesar's military virtue, if you like, using the word virtue in the Latin sense, was communicated to him through that. So I think we are, you know, we live on multiple levels in a sense, and perhaps particularly academics, we identify ourselves with the sort of top of our minds, but in society at large, you could say some ways, you know, the power of images and of the irrational remains very, very potent. It wasn't just in the 1930s. one could say alas, but you know, but of course the images that we relate to now are often not those of traditional religions. So they are for some people in some contexts, but people are now orienting themselves in relation to different sets of symbols. And particularly in a country like Britain, where the majority of people now say they have no religion.
Non-practicing pagans.
Yeah. Well, those who are pagan.
Klimena, may I follow this discussion? And I think it's an interesting question, and it's a very popular one, because most people from the Western tradition, especially from the Protestant milieu, they consider the veneration of icon as a form of superstition. As you mentioned, you know, the kissing of icons, the touching of icons, I mean several attempts to get something from the miraculous icon, for instance, holy water or excurian oil or things like this. So it's the standard, the normal perception of this is even in Russia too, as a kind of traditional superstition for for common people, and even among Russian clerics, there are some quite popular opinions that we should stop this kind of veneration because it's a form of paganism, you may find a lot of materials on the topic. But paradoxically, it's something originally, it's something quite opposite. And I tried to explain it in some of my papers that actually it is a high Platonism behind this tradition, which we call superstition. Because, you know, it's coming back to the concept of icon as hora, icon as space. That is, you know, Platonic concept of Eidos on the background. Because what does it mean, icon? Let us come back to Plato's statement about Eidos. There is a real table, concrete table, and its heavenly image or Eidos above. But it relates to icon. There is an icon is a very concrete object which you may touch, you may destroy, you may do whatever, and ideal image behind it. But actually the ideal icon in Byzantine thinking is a space which connects this very concrete object and its ideal image. It means that through kissing or touching the icon as an object, people are communicating with the heavenly realm in very Platonic way. Naturally, most of them, 99%, never think about, but they're doing a very Platonic, high sophisticated mystical practice of veneration. It looks paradoxical, but it's like this.
Okay, I think that we've had quite a fruitful discussion, which can be continued tomorrow, because I think some of the papers tomorrow will be touching on some of the topics that Professor Pattison mentioned in his lecture today. So there'll still be time to talk about all these interesting issues. And unless someone has a really, really urgent question, I think we should probably come to a close. So I'd like to thank all our participants today. Petra, thank you very much. Professor Pattison, thank you very much as well. And shall we meet again tomorrow? It's again 2:00, and we'll have the last day of our conference.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you.